You're listening to the audio production of In the Footsteps of the Savior, Following Jesus Through the Holy Land, by Max Lucado, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Ben Holland. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
Dean Ellen and I happily dedicate this book to Steve and Ruth Dick. Thanks to your skill, grace, and devotion, tens of thousands of people have walked the land where Jesus walked. May God bless you for being a blessing to Israel. Introduction. Press me to select my favorite spot in Israel, and I will refuse. It can't be done, I will tell you. There are too many. The Garden Tomb, the Via Dolorosa, the Sea of Galilee, the Wailing Wall. How could a person select one over the others? Yet you insist. You want me to winnow the list down to one location. Finally, I sigh and say, okay. I open a map of Israel and lead you and your imagination some 29 miles north of the Sea of Galilee. The site is called Caesarea Philippi, named for Philip II, the third son of Herod the Great. It sits on the northernmost border of Israel, literally on the boundary between Israel and the world. The location is stunning and dramatic. It boasts a cliff, and at its base, a cave. Visitors gaze up at the cliff and down into the yawning mouth of the grotto. Water springs from the ground beneath the cave, resulting in a flowing river of fresh water. While the area is radiantly beautiful, its history is shadowy. Caesarea Philippi has long been associated with idolatry. 14 temples dedicated to the worship of Baal have been identified in the vicinity. Herod the Great erected a temple in the front of the cave for worshiping Caesar Augustus. Neighboring temples were constructed for the worship of Zeus and other gods of the Greek and Roman cultures. One god received more attention than any of the others, Pan, a Greek deity who was thought to have lived in the cave. Worship of Pan involved unspeakable sexual perversion. It's no surprise, then, that an inscription designates the cave and the spring as the gate of hell. Also, the chasm was deeper than any of the ancient peoples could plumb, so they assumed it was an entryway into the underworld, Hades, or hell. It was here, in this location, that Jesus asked his followers the watershed question, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" Matthew 16:13. The followers were quick to answer. Apparently, they were privy to the word on the street. They listed the common assumptions: John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah. Jesus then asked for their opinion. "But what about you? Who do you say I am?" Verse 15. It is as if Jesus deliberately set himself, a humble woodworker, against the religions of the world in all their splendor, in all their glory, and asked, "Who do you say that I am?" On one occasion, while touring Israel, a dozen or so of our tour group were standing together on the grounds. I asked if each of them would be willing to receive and then reply to the question of Jesus. They agreed. So I asked each person, "Who do you say that Jesus is?" And each person, in his or her own words, affirmed the confession made by Peter, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Verse 16. Jesus, upon hearing the words of Peter, declared, "On this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it." Verse 18. Can we imagine Jesus gesturing toward the cave as if defying the devil himself? Hell itself will collapse. All this falsehood, all this immorality, all this deceit and death, it shall not withstand the assault of the church. 2,000 years later, his pronouncement still stands. The proclamation that echoed in the cavern has reverberated through the ages. What a promise, and what a place to make it. This is the wonder of the land where Jesus walked. Each square mile seems to have a message. I pray that the pages of this book bring those messages to life in your life. This weary world is in desperate need of a Savior. Thank God we have one. We can walk where He walked and ponder the promises He made. May you hear Him as He speaks to you. May you be changed as you journey in the footsteps of the Savior. Part 1. The Journey. Cathedral, Bethlehem. Bethlehem, star-filled skies, bone-weary travelers, shepherds, and a new baby. Bethlehem reminds us of the most remarkable event in human history, the moment the Savior came to earth, clothed in humility and humanity. Today, centuries beyond that main event, a small chapel marks the probable birthplace of Jesus. Behind a high altar in the church lies a cavern lit by silver lamps. Enter the main edifice and admire the ancient church. Enter the quiet cave where a star embedded in the floor notes the birth of the King of Heaven. There is one stipulation, however. You must bend down. The doorway is so low, you can't enter standing up. The same is true of Christ. You can see the world while standing tall, but to witness the Savior, you have to get on your knees. Chapter 1. The Arrival. The noise and the bustle began earlier than usual in the village. As night gave way to dawn, people were already on the streets. Vendors were positioning themselves on the corners of the most heavily traveled avenues. Store owners were unlocking the doors to their shops. Children were awakened by the excited barking of the street dogs and the complaints of donkeys pulling carts. The owner of the inn had awakened earlier than most in the town. After all, the inn was full, all the beds taken. Every available mat or blanket had been put to use. Soon, all the customers would be stirring, and there would be a lot of work to do. One's imagination is kindled, thinking about the conversation of the innkeeper and his family at the breakfast table. Did anyone mention the arrival of the young couple the night before? Did anyone ask about their welfare? Did anyone comment on the pregnancy of the girl on the donkey? Perhaps someone raised the subject, but at best, it was raised, not discussed. There was nothing novel about them. They were possibly one of several families turned away that night. Besides, who had time to talk about one specific young couple when there was so much excitement in the air? Augustus did the economy of Bethlehem a favor when he decreed that a census should be taken. Who could remember when such commerce had hit the village? No, it is doubtful that anyone mentioned the couple's arrival or wondered about the condition of the girl. They were too busy. The day was upon them. The day's bread had to be made. The morning's chores had to be done. There was too much to do to imagine that the impossible had occurred. God had entered the world as a baby. Yet, were someone to chance upon the sheep stable on the outskirts of Bethlehem that morning, what a peculiar scene they would behold. The stable stinks, as all stables do. The stench of urine, dung, and sheep reeks pungently in the air. The ground is hard, the hay scarce. Cobwebs cling to the ceiling, and a mouse scurries across the dirt floor. A more lowly place of birth could not exist. Off to one side sits a group of shepherds. They sit silently on the floor, perhaps perplexed, perhaps in awe, no doubt in amazement. Their night watch had been interrupted by an explosion of light from heaven and a symphony of angels. God goes to those who have time to hear him. So on this cloudless night, he went to simple shepherds. Near the young mother stands the weary father. If anyone is dozing, he is. He can't remember the last time he sat down. And now that the excitement has subsided a bit, now that Mary and the baby are comfortable, he leans against the wall of the stable and feels his eyelids grow heavy. He still hasn't figured it all out. The mystery of the event puzzles him, but he hasn't the energy to wrestle with the questions now. What's important is that the baby is fine and Mary is safe. As sleep comes, he remembers the name the angel told him to use, Jesus. We will call him Jesus. Wide awake is Mary. My, how young she looks. Her head rests on the soft leather of Joseph's saddle. The pain has been eclipsed by wonder. She looks at the face of the baby, her son, her Lord, his majesty. At this point in history, the human being who best understands who God is and what he is doing is a teenage girl in a smelly stable. She can't take her eyes off him. Somehow, Mary knows she is holding God. So this is he. She remembers the words of the angel. His kingdom will never end. He looks like anything but a king. His face is prunish and red. His cry, though strong and healthy, is still the helpless and piercing cry of a baby. And he is absolutely dependent upon Mary for his well-being. Majesty in the midst of the mundane. Holiness in the filth of sheep manure and sweat. Divinity entering the world on the floor of a stable, through the womb of a teenager, and in the presence of a carpenter. She touches the face of the infant God. How long was your journey? This baby had overlooked the universe. These rags keeping him warm were the robes of eternity. His golden throne room had been abandoned in favor of a dirty sheep pen, and worshiping angels had been replaced by kind but bewildered shepherds. Meanwhile, the city hums. The merchants are unaware that God has visited their planet. The innkeeper would never believe that he had just sent God into the cold, and the people would scoff at anyone who told them the Messiah lay in the arms of a teenager on the outskirts of their village. They were all too busy to consider the possibility. Those who missed His Majesty's arrival that night missed it not because of evil acts or malice. No, they missed it because they simply weren't looking. Little has changed in the last 2,000 years, has it? The Temple Visit. Life is tough enough as it is. It gets even tougher when we're headed in the wrong direction. One of the incredible abilities of Jesus was to stay on target. His life never got off track. He had no money, no computers, no jets, no administrative assistants or staff. Yet Jesus did what many of us fail to do. He kept his life on course. As the young Jesus looked across the horizon of his future, he could see many targets. Many flags were flapping in the wind, each of which he could have pursued. He could have been a political revolutionary. He could have been a national leader. He could have been content to be a teacher and educate minds, or to be a physician and heal bodies. But in the end, he chose to be a savior and save souls. Anyone near Christ for any length of time heard it from Jesus himself. The Son of Man came to find lost people and save them. Luke 19:10. The Son of Man did not come to be served. He came to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many people. Mark 10:45. The heart of Christ was relentlessly focused on one task. The day he left the carpentry shop in Nazareth, he had one ultimate aim, the cross of Calvary. He was so focused that his final words were, "It is finished." John 19:30. How could Jesus say he was finished? There were still the hungry to feed, the sick to heal, the untaught to instruct, and the unloved to love. How could he say he was
finished? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.